So in this new lecture series brought to you by Agicraft Private Limited, we are going to discuss Newton's laws of motion and we are going to deal with the bodies which have velocity very very less than the speed of light. So we will not discuss Einstein's special theory of relativity. And under the laws of motion or Newton mechanics, we are going to cover all these topics. The first topic that we will go through is uniform motion and non-uniform motion. Then we will have a small discussion on Aristotle and Galileo. And after that, we will study Newton's first law, second law, and third law of motion. And we will also study what is impulse and what are the common forces that act on the body when they are in motion. These forces cover gravitation, tension, spring forces, normal reaction, and friction. And at the end of the lecture, we will solve some problems by using the concept that we will learn from this lecture. So what are basically Newton's laws? Newton's laws are a set of rules or laws that are formulated by Isaac Newton, right, which actually governs the motion of the body under consideration. So let us now first start our lecture by having a small discussion on uniform motion and non-uniform motion.
So our main question is, what can an external force do if I apply an external force on a body? So suppose I have a ball, a football that is at rest, and if I apply a force F on it, say from a kick, let's say I kick the ball, so I will apply an external force on it and it will start to move from its state of rest. So an external force F can move a body from rest in a state of motion. And if I apply a force on it, then the body at rest will start to move in the direction of the applied force. So we see an applied or an external force can bring a body to a motion from its state of rest. Also, the second thing an external force can do is it can stop a moving body. Suppose I have an inclined plane and a body is moving down the inclined plane. Then I can apply an external force in the opposite direction of the motion and can bring this body to rest. So these are the two things that we expect from an external force, that it can move a body which is at rest and it can stop a moving body. So our first question is, do we need an external force to keep a body in uniform motion? A uniform motion is a motion in which velocity is constant for overall period of the motion. So the question is, do we need an external force or an applied force to keep a body in motion? Let's say I have a body that is in uniform motion, and for a uniform motion, V doesn't change with time. So to keep this ball in uniform motion, do I need to apply an external force on it? So Aristotle thought, yes, we do need an external force to keep a body in uniform motion, but his point of view was rejected by Galileo. He proved experimentally that a state of rest and a state of uniform motion are one of the same thing. Let's say I have a ball at rest and a ball that is moving with a constant velocity v in the same direction. So according to Galileo, a state of rest and a state of uniform motion are one of the same thing, and in both cases, the net external force on the body is equal to zero. So the point of view of Galileo inspired Newton to introduce first law of motion, and we will begin our study of Newton's law by studying first law of motion. So let us now discuss Newton's first law. So taking inspiration from the Galileo, Newton came up with the first law of the motion. And according to the Newton first law, a body at rest will remain at rest and a body in uniform motion will continue to move until and unless an external force compels it to change its state. So for example, I have a table and on the table a block is resting, and the block is resting, so it is at rest. So the block is at rest because the net external force will be equal to zero, and the external force that are acting on the system are normal reaction from the ground and the weight of the block. And since these two forces balances out, so the block will be at a state of rest. Let us say I apply a horizontal force F on it. So the net external force will not be equal to zero now, and the block will start to move in the horizontal direction and will change its state, and the block will not be at rest anymore. It will start to move in the direction of this applied force. So we see that previously the block was at rest because the net external force that was from the normal reaction and the weight of the block was balancing and the block was at rest. But when we applied an external force on it, it started to move in the horizontal direction, and the net external force was not equal to zero, and hence the block started to move and compelled it to change its state from the state of rest. Another example that we can consider for a uniform motion order for Newton's first law is, if I have a rocket that is moving with a velocity v in an isolated system, that is, there are no heavenly body or stars around the rocket, so the net external force from the gravitation will be equal to zero, and the rocket will continue to move with a velocity v. So the body or the rocket will continue to move with a uniform velocity or uniform or with a uniform motion. So we see that if the net external force on the system is equal to zero, then the motion is unaccelerated. So net external force is equal to zero, so acceleration A will also be equal to zero, and the acceleration of the block or a body or any system can be zero only if velocity is constant or the block is at rest. So a net external force or a net external non-zero force can only change the state of the system. So let us now discuss inertial frame of reference. So inertial frame of reference are the frame of reference that were introduced by Newton to study the motion of the bodies. The special thing about this frame of reference is that it is unaccelerated. That is, it can be at rest and it can move with a uniform velocity. So consider I have a frame S, then this frame of reference can be inertial only if this frame S will be at rest or it moves with a fixed velocity V for overall period of the motion. We will discuss more about inertial frame of reference at the end of this lecture, when we will also deal with non-inertial frame of reference. So we see that according to Newton's first law of motion, if the net vector sum of all the external forces of the system is equal to zero, then the force is zero, then the system is unaccelerated. That if net is equal to zero, then A is equal to zero, then the system is unaccelerated. It can be at rest or it can move with a uniform velocity.
So let us now discuss inertial frame and the non-inertial frame of reference. So an inertial frame of reference is a frame of reference that moves with a zero acceleration. That is, it doesn't accelerate. So if we have a inertial frame of reference, that means it can either be at rest or can move with a uniform velocity. So if a frame is at rest or is moving with a uniform velocity, it means it is unaccelerated. An unaccelerated frame of reference means its acceleration is equal to zero. So Newton's laws are only valid in inertial frame of reference. So Newton's laws are valid only in inertial frame of reference. So we don't know how to apply
Newton laws and non-inertial frame of reference. So we will now see how to apply Newton's laws in accelerating frame. So how to apply Newton's law in non-inertial frame. Non-inertial frame, that is accelerating frame. A is not equal to zero. So suppose I have a elevator, and in the elevator I have a block of mass m, and if this block is moving upward with an acceleration a naught, then we don't know how to apply Newton's laws in this frame of reference, that is in the frame of elevator, because now we have a accelerating frame of reference and we don't know how to apply Newton's laws in accelerating frame. So suppose that I have two frames I, that is inertial, and another frame Ni, that is non-inertial, and I have a point particle P of mass Mp. The position vector of P with respect to non-inertial frame of reference is Rp Ni, and if this Ni is moving with an acceleration of A ni with respect to I, which is equal to A naught, that means the acceleration of the non-inertial frame of reference with respect to I is A naught, and the position vector of P with respect to inertial frame is RPI. So if I take double time derivative of this position vector, I will get acceleration in the inertial and the non-inertial frame of reference. So API is equal to R double dot PI, and similarly APNI is R double dot PNI. The double time derivative of the position vector give us the acceleration in the respective frames. So if I now apply the triangle law of addition, I'll get A naught plus APNI is equal to APNI. So if I now apply by mass on the both side, that is mass of point particle P on both side, I will get APNI is equal to MPAP with respect to I minus MPA naught. So we have the force in the frame of reference that is moving is equal to force in the inertial frame minus the acceleration of the non-inertial frame. So this part is known as the pseudo force that applies on a body when it is in accelerating frame of reference. For example, let us consider the same example of mass m in an elevator. When we are in elevator, if the elevator is accelerating upward with an acceleration of a naught, then a force of m a naught applies on it in the downward direction. So this force is our pseudo force, that is the force that we experience in our accelerating frame of reference. So the net force that we will feel will be mg plus a naught. So that is why when you are in an elevator and when it moves upward, you feel a little bit heavy, that is you are pulled more towards the ground because of this pseudo force that applies when the frame, that is our elevator, is accelerating upward. So let us now solve more problems on this topic, and we will solve topic that we we will solve some problem that will deal with the non-inertial frame of reference.
So now we will discuss Newton's second law. Newton's second law basically handles a more generalized quantitative form of the first law. So Newton's law, second law basically discusses what happens when a non-zero force acts on a body. So according to the Newton's second law, we have to first define the quantity, which is momentum. So momentum is defined by P is equal to mv, where v is the velocity of the body and m is the mass of the body. So momentum is also a vector quantity. It has a direction and a magnitude, and the unit of the momentum is kg meter per second. So as I said, Newton's second law basically is a quantitative form of the first law, and it basically handles a general case, that is what happens when we have a non-zero net external force acting on a body. So according to the Newton's second law of the motion, we have rate of change of momentum, or delta P upon delta T, proportional to the force applied on the body, and the force applied on the body or the change in momentum take place in the direction of the applied force. So according to the Newton's second law, rate of change of momentum is proportional to the force applied on the body, and the change of momentum take place in the direction of the applied force. So as I said, Newton's first law is basically a qualitative form, and Newton's second law is a quantitative description of the first law, and it handles a more general case. So let's say I have a quantity which is delta P by delta T, which, so I can define P is equal to mv upon delta T, and let us say a body has a fixed mass, so we can write delta V. I'll take m outside because it is a constant and it doesn't change with time, upon delta T. And under the limit delta T tending to zero, we have m dv by dt. So according to the Newton's second law, dp by dt is equal to m dv by dt, and dp by dt is also the force applied on the body. So F is equal to m dv by dt, and this quantity dv by dt is the acceleration of the body on which the force was applied, and the acceleration is in the direction of the applied force. So F is equal to ma. It's the second law of the motion, and as you can see, if acceleration of the system is equal to zero, then the F is also equal to zero. And so basically Newton's second law of the motion is consistent with the first law, which says that if net external force on the system is equal to zero, then the acceleration of the body is zero. That is, the system should be unaccelerated. So we have basically seen that what is Newton's second law and how it handles a general case, that is when we have a non-zero net external force acting on a body, what is the acceleration of the body and how it is related to the rate of change of momentum. So now we will solve a small problem on the basis of the Newton's second law, and then we will move forward to impulse, and then we will discuss Newton's third law. So let us now in this lecture discuss impulse. So to understand impulse, we must first have to understand what is momentum in detail. So momentum is the measure of how difficult it is to stop a moving body. We know from Newton's second law discussion that momentum is defined as mass into velocity, and momentum is a vector quantity. It has a direction, and a direction is in the direction of the velocity. Also, the unit of the momentum is kg meter per second. So, as I told you before, momentum is the measure of how difficult it is to stop a moving body. So, a more massive the particle, more is the momentum, more the velocity, more the momentum. So, suppose I have a bullet that is of mass m, and as you know, the mass of the bullet is very low, and let's say it is traveling at a very high velocity. So, you know, a fast bullet causes a more damage because it carries more momentum with it. So, it is impossible to stop a moving bullet because it has a very high momentum, and the high momentum is due to the fact that it has a very high velocity. So, let us now understand what is impulse. So, impulse we encounter in our day-to-day life situation, like it is a very high increase in force in a very short duration of time. So, for example, if you ever play a game of cricket or baseball, you know, when you hit a ball, at the instant when the ball hit the bat, there is a sudden increase in the force. The increase in the force can be represented by the graph of force between, by the graph of force between time. So from this graph, we can see that there is a sudden increase in the force at a particular instant. And this is the instant at which the ball just hit the surface of the bat. So at that instant, the force is very, very high. And this is the graph for impulse. To calculate the impulse, we have to calculate the integration between force with respect to time. So to calculate impulse, we have to solve this integration. And if you just analyze this formula, you can see that it is kind of like length into little breadth dp. So from this graph, you can see that if dt is a small area, and when you integrate it over all interval of time, impulse is nothing but just the area under this curve. So impulse is area under the force in time graph. So let us now relate impulse with the Newton's second law of motion. So from Newton's second law, we know that force is equal to mass into dv by dt. So if I take time to the other side, so if dt is equal to mdv, and if mass remain constant for overall motion, we can write if dt is equal to m dmv. And as we know, mv is nothing but the momentum of the particle, so dp. Now let us integrate on the both sides. So we will get if dt from initial point to the final point is equal to dp initial to the final point, we have pf minus pi. So as you can see, impulse is nothing but just the change in momentum in a very short duration of time. So let us now analyze a particular case in which we can evaluate the impulse. So for example, I have a ball and we have a marble that is approaching this ball at a velocity v, and after bouncing off from this ball, it retraces to its path, and after hitting the ball, it just bounces back with the same velocity v. So the initial momentum of the ball is mass into velocity in I cap direction. If this side is positive x axis and this side is minus negative x axis, so initial momentum is positive I cap mv, and the final momentum is minus mv I cap. So if I just calculate the change in momentum, I'll get pf minus pi, which is equal to minus 2 mv I cap. So this is the impulse transferred to the ball by the marble when it just hit the wall. So as you know, the change in momentum is just f dt integral, and this is the impulse. So you see how we can just evaluate impulse by calculating the change in the momentum. Now let us do one more problem on the impulse. Let's say I have a marble that is hitting a wall obliquely at an angle theta from the normal, and it just bounces back with the same velocity. Let's say the velocity of approach is v, and velocity at which it bounces back is also v. So if upper side is positive y-axis and this is positive y-cap and this is negative y-axis, so in the y-direction the momentum initial is minus mv sine theta y-cap, and in final momentum in the y-cap direction is minus mv sine theta y-cap. You can just calculate the component of the velocity and multiply it by mass, and can calculate the initial momentum and the final momentum in the y-direction. And when you will just calculate the difference between the momentum, the difference between the final and initial momentum, will get zero. So net impulse transfer in the y-direction is zero. So we see that there is no transfer of impulse in the y-direction. Now let us calculate the same for x-direction. So in the x-direction, initial momentum is minus plus mv cos theta. This is j-cap, sorry. And this is plus mv cos theta i-cap. And the final momentum is minus mv cos theta i-cap. Sorry, I have to just change it to y-cap, and this is theta. So the net change in momentum is minus 2mv cos theta, and this is the impulse transferred to the wall by the marble when it hit obliquely, and there's an angle theta between the normal and the velocity of approach. So we see that how we can calculate impulse by calculating the change in momentum. So to remind you once again, impulse is nothing but a change in momentum, the change of momentum between final and initial point. And from the FT graph, we can calculate the impulse by calculating the area under the curve. To calculate the impulse, we can just calculate the area under the curve, and we'll have the value of impulse. So there's just up until now we have just covered uniform motion, Aristotle and Galileo point of view of studying motions, Newton's first law, inertial frame, Newton's second law, and impulse and change in momentum. Now we'll just start Newton's third law. So let us now understand Newton's third law of motion, which states that to every action there is an equal opposite reaction. So to understand this law of motion, let us consider a simple example. Say this is a wall, and I push this wall with a force F, then the wall will push me back with a force minus F. So if I push a wall with force F, then the wall will apply the same force back on me, but in the opposite direction. So now consider another example. Say I have these two balls or two bodies, A and B, that are approaching each other. And when they just collide, the body B will apply some force on A. Let's say this force is FAB. So force on FAB is force on A due to B. Similarly, when they collide, at an instant when they collide, the body A will apply the force on B too. So force FBA is force on particle B due to A. So according to the Newton's third law, FAB vector is equal to minus FBA vector. This is our Newton's third law. So this is Newton's third law, that if I apply some force on a body, then the body will apply the same force back on me, but in the opposite direction. So let us now consider an important property of the Newton's third law and the second law. Newton's third law and second law together yield a very important result. So say I have two bodies, A and B, and body A is approaching body B with a momentum PA, and body B is approaching momentum the body A with a momentum PB. And when they just hit each other, the direction of the momentum changes and the value will also change. So body A will go back in other direction with a momentum PA dash, and body B will go in the opposite direction with a momentum PB dash. So if I now use momentum, Newton's second law of motion, that is F is equal to dP by dt. So F dt is equal to dP, and dP is nothing but the change in momentum. So I can write FAB, that is force on particle A due to B, is delta T is equal to PA dash minus PB. PA, sorry, PA. Similarly, I can write FPA into delta T is equal to PB dash minus PB. And by now using Newton's third law, which states that FAB, these all are vector quantities, we have to take about the sign of the vector. So Newton's third law now states that FAB vector is equal to minus of FBA vector. So now if I will substitute this expression in this equation, that is equation number 2, I'll get minus FAB delta T is equal to PB dash minus PB. This is equation 3. Now rearranging the terms by transferring the minus sign to the right, I'll get FAB into delta T is equal to PB minus PB dash. So now by equating equation number 1 and equation number 3, I'll get PA dash plus PB dash, and these are all vector quantities, so I have to apply the vector sign. So PA dash plus PB dash is equal to PA plus PB vector. So by using Newton's second law and third law, I have obtained a very important law, that is the conservation of momentum law, and we will use this law in other chapters when we will do problems related to collision. So let us now just discuss common forces, that are gravitation, tension, spring force, normal reaction, and friction. And the friction force are of two types. Friction force is of two types, static friction and the kinetic